All right, Mom, would you mind giving us your intro? Tell us a little bit about yourself.
My name's Michelle Nelson. I am 50. I'm Sonia's mom, but I'm closer to 51. My birthday is December 7th, so pretty soon I'll be 51. I am older than my husband by 3 months. See, I live in Idaho Falls, Idaho. And a fun fact about me is I love to make pie. Apple pie, rhubarb pie, pumpkin pie. We just came back from Thanksgiving. I make an awesome pumpkin pie, don't I, Sonia?
You do.
Thank you. I think all my kids missed it. You know, because they weren't there, except for you. You got some. What's important to me? Mostly family.
Hi, everybody. I'm Darren Johnson, and I'm 50 years old. I live in Idaho Falls, Idaho. And fun facts about me, I love to snowshoe. I love living out west, and I love the winter more than I do the summer. And this is the perfect spot to be for that. What do I value? I would say I value, number one would be my family. Number two would be my faith. Three would be my health. I guess I can tell you a little bit more about that too. I believe you can't enjoy anything unless you have your health. So I'm doing everything I can to take care of things so I can be around for a long, long time. Career is also very important to me. Not to climb the corporate ladder, but to use the talents that God gave me to help people and to do things in life that matter.
So when and where did you guys meet?
We met in Sunday school, probably 1974 or something like that. We went to, we grew up in two, yeah, she grew up in Barrett, I grew up in Hoffman. The towns were 7 miles apart
On the railroad.
on the railroad. And we went, and occasionally our churches, two different churches, but occasionally we had Sunday school together.
Yes.
But then we went to Bible school together
In the summer,
in the summer.
vacation Bible school.
Yeah, and that's where we really got to know each other.
Confirmation.
Confirmation when we were in junior high. And,
Luther League, that was the youth group. Went on a trip to Branson, Missouri.
But didn't really start dating each other until junior, senior year in high school.
Senior year.
Senior year.
Who asked out who?
He
I
asked
asked
out who?
her out. I asked her out. I asked if I could call her. Let me back up. So she was cheerleader for the opposing team's basketball team. Keep in mind, we knew each other like all in. So it's like I'm at the free throw line and I'm saying, "There's Michelle, the cheerleader," right? So
The one and only time I ever cheerleaded.
right, because you're substituting. The school's that small that if you're missing a cheerleader, you just pick someone to step in. So after the game, I quickly showered and ran out and caught her before she left. And she was like halfway to her car. It was really a cold night. Remember that?
Yes, and I
Yeah.
was with a couple of
You
girlfriends.
were. Which raised the stakes.
And he even still asked me.
No, I said, "Could I call you?"
Impressive.
That's all I said.
Well, yes, but they kind of walked a little
I didn't
further
say,
away.
"I didn't say, would you go out?" I said, "Could I call you?" And I just wanted to lead you on a little bit, build the suspense. And so she said, "If you want to," which hurt. And then, so yeah, I called her.
But guys like to chase, Sonia.
Yeah.
So that phone call, was it awkward?
Very awkward.
Was it?
Yeah. Because, you call into the Nelson household, there's like, 8 kids. Well, you only had four home at the time, right?
Probably.
And so, and her mom and dad, and this is back in the day before cell phones, because you couldn't just text someone, right? No. You called and you just prayed that she was the one that would pick up. And she didn't. And so I forget who picked up, but I said, "Hey, it's Michelle there." And then I asked her out, I think. That's my recollection of it anyway.
And you obviously said yes. What was your
Yes.
first
She said
date?
quickly, yes.
We went to the bigger town, 20 minutes away, called Alexandria. We went to Godfather's Pizza and then a movie. Which neither of us can remember which
Making
one.
The grade. That's what it's called. Making the grade.
And then we went to Perkins for a chocolate chipper.
Ice cream and chocolate chip cookies.
Whipped cream. Yeah. A dessert. Because we didn't want the day to end.
Right.
Do they still have chocolate chippers today?
I bet.
Probably. We just don't go to Perkins very much. We have to go and see.
Mm. When did you guys know it was love? Is there a certain moment?
I don't think that there is like a date. Do you remember we got that question from our pastor?
Yes.
In marriage counseling.
Right.
And neither one of us could like pinpoint a day or a date or a time or whatever. And he said good, because it's more of a gradual
process. Yeah, I would agree with that. I don't remember the time. I remember some key. Yeah. Yeah, I agree with your mom.
Okay. We can move on.
He's always very good.
So you had your first date late in high school. Did you guys continue dating throughout college, or was it more of an on and off kind of thing?
It was more on and off. We knew that it was going to be a long distance relationship. So she went down to Winona in Winona State, and I went up to Fargo, North Dakota. That was about a 5.5-hour drive. Mm-hmm. And so the way we communicated were through letters. Also, every Thursday night after Cheers, which was a sitcom on back in the 80s, we would call. We'd have about a 15-minute phone call right after Cheers. And at that time as well, long-distance charges were really expensive. So once you were on the line, it was just quick, 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 hang up, and that was it, because you just couldn't afford it any other way.
We actually had a phone bill. You know, I was living off campus with 4 other girls, so the phone bill would come, and they would highlight their calls and add them all up. And that was how much we owed, and we put 5 checks in to the phone company.
But yeah, it was off and on. It's tough. It was really, really tough just being able to stay connected, you know. Tough.
Not as easy as it is today.
No.
Yeah, so there wasn't,
FaceTime.
I don't know about for you, but there wasn't like another guy for me or anything. It just was that.
There's no guy for me either.
You just didn't really see each other. It's not like you could see each other every weekend even.
But you know, I was telling Sony before, there was no time to do much. You were working all the time. I was working all the time. So it was just nonstop. Even if we wanted to see someone else, who had the time? Right?
Right. And I don't know about for your major, but for nursing there was an awful lot of reading and studying and papers, and I never could keep up. So we just always were studying or working.
How long did you guys date before marriage?
We dated, hold on, Michelle, let me take a shot at this. We started dating in our senior year of high school. Mm-hmm. Then in college, we dated off and on. But in our junior year is when I proposed to Michelle. So we were engaged for 2 years. Mm-hmm. And then we got married. Right after she was done, both of us done with our 4-year degree.
Of college. Technically about 4.5 years, maybe. Yep.
When did you guys realize you wanted to marry each other?
Oh boy.
Or propose?
Well, probably that junior year in college.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't really remember when.
Not a certain moment, just a gradual thing.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good question. I really don't know.
I think dementia's starting in, Sonia.
Yeah.
I don't know.
How did Dad propose?
It was at another couple's wedding. He was a groomsman in Paul and Lisa Peterson's wedding. And sometime during the wedding dance, We just went for a walk outside, but he had to go back to his car to get something.
So you knew.
And the something, well, I didn't know until then, and then I saw kind of a something you stuffed in your pocket.
Oh.
Did you know that?
No.
Yeah, I saw you stuff something in your pocket.
Mm-hmm.
So, I can't remember what you said, why we had to go to the car.
I don't remember.
I don't know. But anyway, their reception was at a ballroom on a lake. And so we were walking, and we walked on a dock out onto the lake. And that's where you proposed.
That's exactly right.
Did you have a big speech, or was it just short and sweet?
I think it was short and sweet. That's what I remember. Was it?
You know, you're going to kill me, Sonia, but I don't remember exact words.
No, it was short and sweet.
But it doesn't really matter. I got the point.
That's true.
Yeah,
that's
it was
true.
Short and sweet.
What was your wedding like?
Wedding was way too expensive. A message to everyone out there, do not go into debt to pay for your wedding.
Don't take out a loan.
We didn't, our parents couldn't afford, you know, we didn't want to ask our parents to help pay for the wedding, so we paid for the wedding. So we were working our way through college, and so we paid as much as we could through our own you know, efforts. Then we took out a loan. So we started out as a young married couple in debt.
In debt, yeah.
And so it was a fantastic wedding, beautiful wedding, nice church wedding, nice reception, and
no.
Buster. We'll get them off here later, but it was way too expensive. So don't do it. Elope. Do something other than do not go into debt and have a nice wedding. You can have a nice wedding, not spend a lot of money.
Yeah, but even our wedding wasn't. Expensive compared to nowadays.
No, it wasn't like we had, you know, swans running around the ballroom. It was, it was just a nice wedding.
So did you guys have a lot of money starting out? Obviously not if you started out in debt.
No. In fact, Sonia, he went on to get his master's degree, so he was going to school. So I was working as a registered nurse at a hospital in Fargo, North Dakota. And you went to NDSU, right?
Well, North Dakota State, yeah. Teaching assistant. I made $500 a month. And then they waived my tuition as well. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
So, no, it would be so tight that when that $500 check came, I would immediately drive to the bank and deposit it because we were timing our bills such. Because we were,
mm-hmm.
you know, paying the electric bill or whatever so we wouldn't get overdrawn. So, no, we didn't have a lot of money starting out.
I think I got $12 an hour when I started as a nurse.
With money being so tight, did you wait to have kids or start right away?
Well, you go right ahead.
Well, we had kids within the first 2 years.
So we started right away.
So basically we started right away.
Why? Why did you start right away? Oh, I'm sorry, it's your question. No, why did you start right away? I mean, that's important. That's an important point.
Yeah, why did you start right away, Mom?
I always wanted to be a mother. I always wanted to have a family.
Did you always want kids, Dad?
Yes, I did. We talked about that, though. When do we... we had our kids really young or early in our marriage, and some of our friends, they were going to Cancun and, you know, buying all these cars and just, you know, our perception was living the good life because they were waiting till they had kids. We decided to have kids early. I think, Michelle, your argument was you want to have the kids early to reduce the risk of birth defects.
Or have trouble getting pregnant.
There you
so
go.
Many people had trouble getting pregnant.
Especially if you're on the pill for a long time and all that.
Mm-hmm.
And also we were just rolling the dice that we would have our kids out of the house when we were
young enough
to
enjoy retirement,
right,
and life and be able to go visit you guys and be young enough if we had grandchildren.
And you don't know what's going to happen, right, with your health, but so far so good. We hope that that's now that some of our friends, their kids are in junior high. And So now we're the ones going to Mexico and they're doing school activities.
Yeah. And we didn't want to be like 60s having somebody in high school in our 60s or something.
Right. Each to his own. We just didn't want that. We wanted the kids to be out of the house by the time we're 50.
Mission accomplished, mm-hmm. You two.
Yeah.
Can you describe your kids? Who's your favorite?
Well, my favorite is Buster. That's the dog. No, I'm kidding. We don't really have any favorites. Our oldest is Hannah. And then comes Sam.
Hannah's 26.
Sam is 25. Four, almost 25. Very soon he'll be 25. And Sonia is...
Do you know how old I am, Dad?
Is 19.
Older than 18.
She's 19. She's 19. So we had girl, boy, girl. All very different children.
What are they like?
Hannah is actually a lot like her dad. Very business oriented. Very type A. She's the firstborn, parent pleaser.
Yeah.
Wants to keep the family together.
Yeah, Hannah's more of a typical, what I would call more the typical first child.
Mm-hmm.
Like Michelle said, very, very, very driven, very, wants to achieve things, very kind of a list person. She'll write a list down just to check it off the list. And that's what keeps her going.
Yeah, very goal-oriented.
Yeah. Sam and Sonia are much more alike. They're goal-oriented as well, but just not in quite the visible way that Hannah is, like a list. But they're much more, I would say, much more laid back,
mm-hmm.
much more chill,
much more relaxed
about life. And
like their mother,
yeah,
a little bit.
Right, more like the Nelson side, Michelle's side.
Mm-hmm.
They all three are wonderful human beings, and they are going to do incredible things with their life. They already have. We're really proud of each one. But you know, they're going to find their own way in life, and hopefully our hope and our prayer is that they find what makes them happy, and that they will land in a spot that with their job, their vocation, their relationship, whoever they're with, that they land in a spot that, you know, where they should be, and that they're happy mm-hmm. about it. That's what we hope for.
Right, and they're also talented in so many different things, so it's hard to pick. Like even with you, Sonia, going to college now, you know, there's so many different majors I could see you in, but we just have to wait and see what you, you know, guess you've already kind of decided, but sometimes people change their mind, we just wait and mm-hmm. see what. How you end up?
We'll see. Do you have any special or funny memories of raising us?
Well, you, Sonia, did a lot of jumping from a high step on the stairway, just trusting your dad that he would catch you. Sometimes you didn't even give you any warning, and this little body was just flying.
Yeah, I trust.
And he caught you every time.
Yeah, there's so many funny memories. I would say for you, Sonia, you're just such a happy little girl. I remember when we were moving from Evansville, Indiana to Minnesota for a job relocation. Oh my gosh, I was just a wreck. Because it was just an emotional time moving from a town we loved and a new job. And so I was driving the U-Haul, and Sonia was in the seat next to me. And she was just cracking jokes the whole time, making me laugh, making me smile. So, yeah, no, she's just a really, really a good kid. And we would, another memory, remember when I was driving back and forth to Chicago?
Mm-hmm.
On Sunday nights, before I would leave and hop in the car, we'd have a football game. You were too little, though. I think you were in the stroller. No, you were out and about. You just couldn't catch a football. You were so little. But we would just have a little family football game, and then I would hop in the car and drive mm-hmm. 6 hours to Chicago and work there for the whole week. But that, I remember that those football games were fun because it was just a good, you know, good family time. And then I would be gone the whole week, so it's a good way to start the week with a little football game.
It's fun watching you play soccer, too.
Oh, soccer. My gosh.
Soccer was nothing that we grew up with, and all three of you guys played soccer.
Yeah.
Really well, I might add.
Who was the best?
Mm.
You were.
You were.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, no, we could talk for hours
Don't
about
tell
favorite
Anna
memories.
And Sam.
Yeah, we talk for hours about favorite memories.
All right, so you mentioned driving back and forth from Chicago.
Yes.
Could you talk more about both of your careers and the challenges of raising kids with both parents working?
Yeah, so I'll go first. So because family was, we believed that family was so important to us, we made choices. And I still don't know if those are the right choices or not, but those are the choices that we made. So when the kids were really young, our two older ones, when they're little, this is before Sonya came along, I was a pharmaceutical sales rep in Minneapolis, St. Paul area. And Michelle was a nurse in a hospital in St. Paul. And so daycare for those two kids, that was just ridiculous. It was so expensive. So Michelle would work nights. I forget the hours of that, Michelle, but and evenings. And we would time it such that I would meet Michelle at a parking lot in the suburbs, and she would then drop off the kids into my company vehicle, and I would take the kids the rest of the evening, and then she would get home at whatever, midnight or 2 a.m, and then we'd get up and do it all over again, because we didn't want to put the kids in daycare. Because a couple things, right? It was very expensive, but also every time they went into daycare, they'd get sick, they'd get, so that's right?
Yeah.
Did I miss anything?
They did end up in daycare sometimes, but about 3 hours a day.
Yeah.
I always would feel bad because when every once in a while they'd have to be there for a day, and some kids got there like at 6 a.m. and they were still there at 6 p.m., or later. But ours never had to do that. Yours was usually about 3 hours a day. As a nurse, it's a more flexible schedule, so I took different schedules. Sometimes I worked 12-hour weekends every weekend and got paid full-time, even though it's not as many hours.
That's right.
But people don't always like to work the weekends, so I had a schedule like that. So then I was home all week, but then I was gone every weekend.
And then I would have the kids on the weekend, and that's when we would have, I loved that. I know you missed out a lot. We had so many fun memories. We'd go to Afton State Park, go for hikes, and just go on these little adventures. Mm-hmm. And so that was a lot of fun. But it was, it was about Michelle.
Yeah.
And then what we decided, though, that if we were really going to try to get you back staying home more, that I needed to make more money. And so as fate would have it, I got an opportunity to take a management role in Chicago. And so at first I said no, but the more we talked about it, it's like maybe this is a chance to get more responsibility, get new experiences, make more money, salary, and also have a chance at a little bit bigger bonus every year, which would then give us more flexibility to allow Michelle to work part-time.
Mm-hmm.
Not even stay home, but to work part-time.
Yeah, as he went up in his pay, I went down in my hours.
And then eventually you quit working and stayed home?
Mm-hmm. With you. It happened about with you. I was still what they call PRN, kind of an on-call nursing. I didn't have a regular schedule. And then I could pick and choose. And I did work a little bit when you were in school.
But yeah, that time in Chicago, that we worked a lot of hours.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, remember in Elkhorn when we lived there, how many hours I was working?
Mm-hmm.
Basically, that move to Chicago to make the extra money. It was, I've never worked harder in all my life. It was some longest hours, the highest stress. It was fun, but it was also just brutally long hours. But it achieved the goal.
It paid off. You worked your way up, right?
Yeah, it paid off, but also for that time period when I was driving back to Chicago, you know, I was gone from Sunday night through Thursday night. I'd get home at midnight on Thursday night. Mm-hmm. I'd spend Friday and Saturday home, and on Sunday, get up and do it all over again. So it came at a cost, but that's, you know, such as life. There are those trade-offs, and who knows if it's the right thing to do or wrong thing to do, but it's a choice we made.
What are the differences between, like, you guys struggling to make ends meet and raising us while working? Like, what's the difference between that and your life now? With your schedules and, like, money?
You want to take a shot?
Well, he makes more money now than he did when we were raising, or when you guys were small. And we also have two kids out and on their own. And
helps.
Just that helps a lot. No, we've just got one left. But yeah, so it's a totally different situation. We probably have less expenses except for college right now. But two kids in college is way more expensive at the same time.
Yeah, we have more income, but not we say that not in a entitled way or anything. We have more income now because we're a lot older, and we've really worked really hard to get that. So we've moved, gosh, Michelle, how many times? We've relocated easily.
Yes.
8 or 9 times with the company I was with at the time, Bristol Myers Squibb. It's all over different parts of the country, taking jobs and roles that increase my level of responsibility. And went back to get my MBA in St. Louis, and that was significant investment in loans and also tuition for me and for us to pay that off. That was an expensive school to go to. And also just the commitment of, you know, for those 2 or 3 years, the drive time and the expenses, the hotels and the gas money and weekends away. And so that increase in responsibility that I now have, but also increase in income, doesn't just happen. It does require just a boatload of work. And there again, I don't know, I don't think I ever will know if it's worth the trade-off. It's an investment that if you really want it, you have to go get it. That's how I look at it.
Mm-hmm. And with all the moves, I would have to say, you know, who knows if that was the right thing or not, but I will say that we have 3 kids, and even us, we're very adaptable.
Yeah, they are.
From going through all the moves and working your way up, are there any big lessons you've learned and would like to share?
Lessons that I've learned through this, there was a point in time when I was at Bristol Myers when I was so ambitious and trying to move up the corporate ladder. I remember when I was probably about, I don't know, somewhere in my late 30s, when I just realized I'm not sure what I'm chasing or why I want to advance. I just knew I needed and I wanted to climb that corporate ladder. And so that was a bit of an epiphany to me at the time was, you know, okay, so now I made it to, in this, whatever status it was the VP role. I thought, man, is this it? Because I'm in my late 30s, and is this really it? And so that was a moment for me when I was thinking about what fulfillment really is, or what happiness really is. And if you think you're going to get it through your career or through a title, that's such a trap. And I think a lot of people fall into that trap. I know I did, that a title is going to mean happiness. It's a lot more than that. You got to find out what brings value in your life, and I think I found it in subsequent roles, but I had my blinders on. I just needed to get that next rung, that next level, to try to make that next income because of what we want to do for our family at the time. How about you?
And for me, with moving and changing statuses in the job, I think the first move was really hard for me, leaving your house and just the home and the life that you've created. And then after we did it a couple times, it was easier, and the experiences we got at each new place. I don't think I'd trade them. I learned that, you know, a house is really just a house. A home is where your family is. And you can make a home anywhere. And I learned not to get attached to things, stuff. You know, it's just a house.
One other thing that I want to add too is that what I've learned is that you have, in my experience, you really have to go through some pain in order to achieve the goals you want. And so an example of this would be a job or a role that is not that glamorous, but it teaches you a lot. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of hours, but it gives you that experience. My advice is do it and go through it, because through that experience, you learn so much. And in the end, I still believe in today's economy that hard work pays off and the good guys win in the end. Even though it doesn't seem so at the very beginning, if you just stick to it and you just do the right thing and you work as hard as you can, that is rewarded. But so often people don't want to put the work in, or they quit too soon. I see it all the time. Younger employees expect to get to a certain level or make a certain income without having proven themselves doing any other work. So I would say celebrate the work and try to find that balance so you don't sell your soul and sacrifice the family in a way. So that's what I would say.
Thank you, guys.
If I could take a look through picture frames and books, I wonder what it is I'd see. Cities, lights, and sunsets, faces I don't know yet. Think of what the time can bring.